Gretch, it's only been a week that you took off, but it feels like it's been forever. Welcome back, sir.
Yeah. Yeah. Missed last week. Enjoyed a week off. Did a little bit of some stuff on the side. Did a little stuff with the family. Yeah. Glad to be back.
It's both recharge season, and then it's also like staring down the barrel of 2022 drafts and content and stuff. And it's like, all right, now here we go again. The meme, the guy in a Grand Theft Auto, just like, yeah, all right, let's go.
Pat and I were talking about this not too long ago. Like, it felt like late December. It's like every time I do stealing signals, I get to the end of the year and I'm like, all right, as soon as I get to January, gonna get a chill. And then it's like, no, you're gonna watch the playoffs and you're gonna be very into that, and then the Super Bowl's now even later. It goes into mid-February. You have the combine right behind it. Free agency mid-March. Draft in April. There's no time off.
There isn't. Yeah, and I mean, you didn't even mention. I mean, there's a very good chance. I don't want to speak for all of you. I will be in these USFL streets. I mean, we're going to get that late April well.
USFL, I'm definitely grinding.
I think I'll be in on that as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have a full catalog of shows. I mean, it's been fun. I think it was like, must have been 2 years now where, because when Pat and I first started the podcast, you know, we took the kind of the summers in the off season off, or at least the spring and early summer. And then it'd be like, oh, football season starting up, we'll fire up the podcast. And then we're like, no. Ship chasing is year round now. We're definitely not starved for content. That's for sure.
We're really not. Yeah. Although, and Ben, you cut out a little bit because I'm having various audio issues that I think I just solved. So apologies if I repeat anything that you said. But the whole thing with like the year round content, I don't recharge with like the idea of like let's like rip off next year, like draft all the same players, like, and then just figure out which order to take them in again. It's really the prospects that get me fired back up, because you're like, oh man, this guy's good. And I don't watch a lot of college football, so it's like it's like rejuvenating to see. You get to see like who's coming in the league. You get to be excited about certain guys, and in some ways, like having not been like a part of that conversation thus far, allows me to kind of jump in and then like see who, like, I end up being excited about guys that other people aren't excited about, or vice versa, and then it's kind of interesting to see what I'm missing, and it just ends up being kind of a fun process.
Yeah, and Gretch, I was listening to you and Sean on Stealing Bananas talk just a little bit about this upcoming draft class. And I guess the consensus for a while was it wasn't that great of one. But Sean was kind of making the take that there's no reason this running back class couldn't be, you know, as good all around from a fantasy production standpoint, some fun receivers. So are things looking good on that end?
Yeah, that's how he's looking at it. I haven't looked at it a ton. Pat said he's looked at it some. But the receivers I know are really good. There's like four really good ones at least, right? There's that all could go in the first round, according to Sean. We have Burks from Arkansas, London from USC, who might not go first round, then the two Ohio State guys. I love it.
Yeah. And there's a guy from Alabama that looks pretty good too.
Oh, right. He tore his ACL in the national championship, though, right? That's Jameson.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah. I should also mention,
he's a good prospect, though.
Yeah,
I haven't got a chance to read it yet, but I do know the RotoViz rookie guide has hit the shelves. Can definitely, sight unseen, give that a stamp of an approval there. So if you're looking to get in those streets early, I highly recommend that. We are going to do Underdog launched a tournament. They had just done self-contained leagues for a little bit for the 2022 season. They did launch their first tournament, I believe $50,000 up top. So we're going to draft one of those in a bit. But I also wanted to touch base with Gretch on Omnifantasy. I think the Super Bowl is really our last kind of domino, but a lot of our leagues and the three of us each hosted one last year. Those are kind of pretty much wrapped up now, right, Ben?
Yeah, it's Omnifantasy is back. That was part of the reason I took off last week. We got the draft set up for this year. We did the three last year. It's three 12-team leagues that each of us was in one, and we'll have to figure out how we want to do that for 2022 again. But I was looking at them. Pete's league is decided. Paul was the runaway winner. He's the overall winner. But mine and Pat's leagues actually are going to come down to the final event. The only event left is the Super Bowl, and there's like a direct head-to-head on the top on both. The team who has the Rams is in second right now and would take over first if they won. So that's kind of cool that those are both going to come down to the final event.
Yeah, so this is Paul's team in my league here. Who ended up really carrying him here, Gretch?
I mean, I was looking at it earlier. So there's a couple things I always look at is like, you know, how many winners did you get, which is in green. So he had three. He had first and second round picks were winners. New York City FC and MLS is a winner. And then runners up are in blue. And so you have the Canadians as well. So you're kind of looking at those. Those are the big ones. But also just, I mean, I think the big story of his is like 12 of his picks scored points. He only has six picks there that didn't score any points, which no one else like really got anywhere near that. So that's really the big one. You go to the bottom, he took Cincinnati in the 17th round in college football. I was looking at some ADP stuff today of like the 10 most like similar leagues. I was calling like the standard leagues, and our three leagues were part of those. Because you know, there's a bunch of different leagues, but a lot of people aren't doing all the same sports. They weren't using MLS and all these other things. Of those 10 leagues, though, this was the only Paul was the only person to pick the Cincinnati Bearcats in college football, and they went to the college football playoff. He nailed it for 30 points.
That's awesome.
A money pick, yeah.
The skeleton key was football teams from Cincinnati. Apparently, you said yes, I was reading your write up, and you said no one drafted Cincinnati across all the leagues.
My biggest one, which is not part of the other thing either, because it's a 16 person league. You know, I tried to keep the for ADP to keep the parameters to 12 team league, same set of you know contests of leagues, whatever NFL, MLB, all those. The one that I do that it's my oldest one is a 16 person league now, and it has so it's deeper. And the very last pick, Mr. Irrelevant pick, was the Cincinnati Bengals. And that dude came all the way back and won it with that.
Holy cow.
Yeah.
So he's already won it, even just getting them to
the Super Bowl. He pulled into a tie. I added a tiebreaker on the site when I made the site. I had forgotten I did this, but I found it. And it's the latest point scoring team wins. So that, like, keeps drama or whatever. With the AFC Championship win, he pulled into a tie. He needed them to beat the Chiefs, but he now has the tiebreaker. So he won it.
So essentially football is the tie. If football is the tiebreaker,
which I think makes some sense. Number one, it's the best sport, but two,
it's
also
the best sport. So
it's the furthest away when you're drafting. Like, I mean, imagine taking the Bengals at 75-1 in last freaking February.
Yeah.
And then coming around and hitting them in the Super Bowl. Like that's harder to do than take like, you know, the sports that are like already in season. When we draft this year, we're going to be drafting NBA, which is already in season. It's for this year.
Right.
We have more information for those sports. I think the ones that are farther off in the schedule are a little, you know, a little tougher. You get a little bonus. You get the tiebreaker for that.
That's a rational, well-made point, but also it's football, man.
It's football.
Gretch, I realize I'm being a bad host tonight because there are probably a decent amount of people that don't know what the hell we're talking about. I know our hardcore ship chasers who have been in these leagues are familiar, but can you give the kind of elevator pitch for what OmniFantasy is? And I have the main schedule up here on the screen.
Yeah, this is just a thing that I got invited to in 2015, started doing on my own, or 2014, started doing on my own in 2015. It's basically fantasy drafts meet the futures market. You draft teams instead of players. You get points for when your team wins a championship in their sport. All the final eight of each sport get points, but obviously the champion gets, you know, the most points. So, like, putting that in context, like in the NFL, every team that made at least a divisional round, you got something for. In terms of, like, you know, when he was showing the big board there of Paul's draft, the teams that were in orange, they were like quarterfinalists. The teams that were in yellow were semifinalists. The teams that were in blue were the runners up, and the teams that were in green were the overall champions for those sports. So for each of the sports, it's a consistent scoring system across all the sports. The champion gets the same number of points across all the different sports, the runner up, quarterfinalists, semifinalists, same amount of points are awarded to each sport. So nothing is weighted too heavily. But yeah, you draft the team from each and every sport, and then it just kind of it's a draft only league. It's like a best ball league, but you know, there's no best ball scoring. It's draft only. It sits in the background all year, and then we look at it in February and we go, hey, none of my teams won.
it's super fun too because it has the similarities to when you're doing even like a fantasy football draft, where there's obviously like the individual player takes or whatever team takes that you think are going to do well. But then there's also, you know, in this case, team scarcity, but like positional scarcity. Some leagues, you know, you, all of the teams are going to be used, like MLS or WNBA, others, college sports, you have a ton to choose from. So there's even more layered game theory, like based on how you allocate your picks. It does kind of mirror itself to how you think about, you know, positional stuff with fantasy football.
Yeah. Some of the sports feel a lot like running backs, you know, like, maybe you could take one in the first round if they have legendary upside or whatever, but otherwise you're just kind of punting it and taking it late. Some of the other ones are like, I can sprinkle this all throughout, you know, middle rounds and all of that. And so all the different sports are a little different. There's a Substack that I kind of wrote up some of the stuff that I've learned over the years doing this. It's omnifantasy.substack.com. If you're playing it or if you're curious, you can go there and just read them all. They're all free posts. But yeah, there's some strategy stuff there where I went league by league, kind of talked about the past results that we've had in terms of like whether it was a later round pick. But it's cool too, because it's directly applicable to the futures market. Like playing this for 7-8 years, whatever I have, I've learned a lot of stuff that, I mean, I don't have legal sports betting, but if I did, I'd be making a ton of futures bets based on this stuff. I mean, one of the things I wrote in today's newsletter was MLB, what I wrote last year was 100% correct for the two teams that were in the World Series. It was about not targeting the very top odds, targeting teams that had a good shot to win their division, which in the MLB gets you straight to the quarterfinals. And that's the way their playoff structure is. And then it's always been known as kind of a crapshoot in the playoffs. And the Braves were like the fifth best odds when we drafted last winter. The Astros were like the 10th or 12th. And those are the two teams that made it to the – but they were both favored to win their division and get to sort of the crapshoot playoffs. The Astros were actually just a lot better than people thought. But it was cool to see that, like, I was reading through what I wrote last year and then kind of going through and looking at the results. I was like, this is exactly what, you know, the past results had suggested about MLB, which, again, for this year, you can apply to the futures market if you just want to look at it that way or – you know, however you want to go about it, but there's different lessons from different sports that I think are fun to learn when you play this.
And Gretch,
yeah, and I think it's,
oh, go ahead.
Well, it's a similar kind of, it's fun in some ways, right? With fantasy football, if you're like hardcore fantasy football, you're kind of like learn that, like, you know, there's probability and, you know, things aren't going to always work out the way they're projected to work out, etc. But there is something that's kind of nice about that, like, initial learning curve where you just get like really tilted when things don't happen the way they're supposed to. And that's how I felt doing this with basketball, where Gretch told me basketball is very predictable. So I believe I took the Brooklyn Nets. That didn't work. You know, you take all the Lakers So it's funny because you're like, all right, you think you got it, but then it's like all this variance and that variance in that, and actually like being wrong and is kind of how you learn and how you get like more invested in some of these sports, or you like remember certain outcomes, like, you know, watching the Nets lose last year in the playoffs, like that stuck with me because I had taken them in a bunch of teams where, even though I literally live in Brooklyn, I might not even watch that game had it not been for Omnifantasy.
Yeah, and I just posted a link in the chat. Gretch spun up another Substack, omnifantasy.substack.com. I'll list it in the show notes. But if you're kind of trying to get a base level of familiarity, Gretch has posted some updates. He has all the you know, the points explained, some strategy stuff in the archives there. So you can get caught up to speed. And Sam asking, are we going to be starting new Omnifantasy leagues? Definitely. When will those officially open for business for 2022?
They're ready to start whenever. We can do the ship chasing ones whenever you guys want. We basically have, I mean, the first events are, there's like the round of 16 in the Champions League, which is the European Soccer League that we do. Those start here in like mid-February. It's actually the second event on that schedule there. So it's like, you know, it starts next Tuesday. The Tuesday after the Super Bowl, not next Tuesday. And so, you know, ideally you'd be done by then, but it's only the first leg, and the second leg of those round of 16 matchups, they play two legs, is in March. March is really when you want to be done, because that's when college basketball starts. College basketball is the first sport where it's like, it comes in hot and heavy. The Champions League schedule is really spread out. The college basketball, obviously, you know, March Madness, there's the first two weekends, it whittles down from 64 teams to four, right? They do the Thursday to Sunday and then Thursday to Sunday. By the second Sunday, it's the, you know, you're already gotten out of the Final Four. So you want to be done before the college basketball playoffs start for sure.
Yeah. Sam, our stat chasing brother here, he wants to know about F1. I mean, this is the Netflix series. It's added?
It's added. Yeah.
It's added. Done.
Boom, there you go, Sam.
Yeah.
There
you go. Everyone asked for it. We added it. It's super top heavy. My longest running league, we started last night. Three of the first four picks were F1 drivers because, like, we have the expected points on there, and the odds just point you towards F1. This is why I didn't have it before, but people want it so bad that we added it. They're going to be the top picks in every league. So congrats. So,
all right, let's go. I'm going to take F1. Screw this NBA thing. You know, you take all these top NBA teams and the Bucks win. I want some F1 drivers.
Look at this. I mean, the expected points, we got Netflix. I mean, these guys are going to be just flying off the shelves in drafts.
Oh yeah. They're going to be right at the top, but it's kind of cool too. Cause I mean, certainly if you had the top pick, you could take one of those and it feels like they have a really good shot of finishing near the top. And that's great. At the same point, like in my league where three of them went in the first four picks, I don't think that'll happen in every league, but it means that the people picking like fifth could take like Alabama, you know, Alabama Crimson Tide. Oh. The first four picks were just the F1 and Djokovic, who's such a, you know, good pick in tennis. Then you get Alabama, and then you get, and later in the first round, you still get an opportunity to take some really nice, you know, picks that would probably otherwise go in the middle of the first round. So having one of these really top heavy sports is kind of nice. It pushes some of the other picks down in the first round.
Jeremy Nelson, testimonials.
I was a bit or not.
I think he's dead serious. He says, I was a robust American football drafter and punted on soccer until way too late. Yeah, that'll get you. That'll get you there.
Classic mistake.
I pulled up the, you were just sharing. Let me share these. Let's see. Big board. What's this? It's on my second screen right now, so I'm going to be looking up, as you guys are well aware.
All right.
So this was Pat's league. No, this was Pete's league. So this was the final standings. Paul dominated 470 points. You get 80 for a first place team. So these are some of the teams he hit 80 on, then 50 for some. His team isn't quite as exciting, or your league isn't quite as exciting as the other leagues I wanted to share too, but this is how Pete's league went. How do I share? How do I flip? I have to stop and then share again.
You can tell it's old because it shows my Twitter name is Petey Pax. You know what? Because this was, I believe this week was the Top Shot show from last year, because it was your Omni Fantasy article that Pat and I were pretending to have read, I think.
That's right.
Maybe.
That's
and
right.
Today, yeah. I read it in full, Ben, because I wasn't distracted by any other NFTs.
Nice. So this is Pat's league. Tonkleberry has been the leader here. He didn't do any, like, you can look, I mean, by sport, he didn't have anything early on in the season, didn't get anything college basketball or UCL Champions League. But he hit on NBA for 80 points. Whoever won in NBA, he had probably NHL, et cetera, et cetera. You see some of these where, like, Willis had 130 in MLB. That means he took a flex pick. You get a couple flex picks. And so he hit on – he just said in the chat he had both the Braves and the Astros. So he got the 80 for the Braves and the 50 for the Astros. Nailed that. But Tonkleberry has 360. You see Hodge here has 330. But this expected points thing is updated. He still has some expected points left out or hanging on there where I was circling the wrong screen here. He still has some expected points hanging on. I was also circling this a minute ago. This is where Willis had the 130. Hodge has his expected points. This is the Rams. So he he has a shot to get to from the Rams already have 50 scored. They could get to 80 if they win. And he'll tie with Tonkleberry, but he'll have the tiebreaker. So he will be the winner. So if we go over to NFL, there's these little team pages. The only teams left are the Rams and the Bengals. Nobody drafted the Bengals in this league, but the Rams are sitting there. Hodge has them as a seventh round pick. So it's literally coming down to the final event on the OmniFantasy calendar. And then the same thing is true. And we better give these guys their due. So let me flip up my league because they kicked my butt too. Same thing is true in my league where.
So here's the big dilemma. I mean, is Hodge going to go hedge and place a money line bet on the Bengals here, you know, or is he going to let this ride?
I mean, I think that's a good question. This is my league where in Sam's league where I got stomped. But yeah, Mike Toops has been dominating the whole time. Spence had both the Rams and the Niners. So he had both of the NFC's semifinalists. You see over here, already has 80 locked up for NFL. That was the 30 points for the Niners for becoming a semifinalist and the 50 for the Rams. But the Rams could jump to 80. He could wind up with 110 total NFL points, would push him to 370 over top of two. So two of these leagues come down to the final event, which is pretty sweet. But Paul, congrats to Paul in Pete's league. He had 470. He won the overall with that awesome draft where he got points from 12 of his 18 picks.
Yeah, and I should give an update. So we did some individual buy-ins for our leagues. We said we were donating half of the prize pool to Chris Wessling's GoFundMe. I was updating people in my league on that today. Also, just a very cool tie-in. If you guys follow Lakeisha on Twitter or Instagram, she's so, so excited and rightfully so to have the Bengals, which was Chris Wessling's team, grew up in Cincinnati, loved them. And then the Rams, which are her team, you know, followed them from St. Louis to LA. So to have a Rams Bengals Super Bowl is just so, so perfect this year for them. And so we made a donation there. I put the 360 to the GoFundMe over there. And then Paul also is winning some ship chasing merch for finishing first overall. So congrats to all the winners in the future winners. And we're looking forward to running it back again here.
John Gonzalez also tweeted out a video as they were watching the Bengals win that game. It's pretty great. If you guys are curious, check that out.
It's so great. And I will say, I don't know if you guys, if you are on Instagram, I recommend following Lakeisha. She's a very fun follow on there. And she documents Link, her and Wes's cute little kid. And he's absolutely hilarious. So if you want to get updates on the world of Lakeisha and Link, I highly recommend it. And yeah, it's nice that she's in what I would hope is an emotional free roll for this Super Bowl, that she's going to be pretty happy no matter what happens there.
Yeah, that's crazy. that's just crazy that's who's in there this year.
Yeah, to have your two teams that mean so much to you that were actual long shots, both four seeds to meet there. Yeah. I mean, the world is works in serious ways. All right, so the people are chomping at the bit. We have Nick saying, "Have they done the big board draft yet?"
So before we do the big board draft, I did, because we were getting questions about if there were any teams in the gauntlet, et cetera. We should probably mention that we do have a team, a penta team with Blair, and Hassan, that is currently in ninth place in the football or in the FFPC playoff tournament, the original. And I believe it can get up to fifth place. We're blocked from finishing higher than fifth. But we can still finish fifth. Yeah. So that's pretty nice. So we need Jamar Chase. Now I assumed everyone must have Cup here that's up this far. So I didn't check, but we're in fifth place among the teams that have Chase. So we just need to pass Mixon. And one of the teams ahead of us actually has McPherson. So hopefully we should move up a spot, but the way he's kicking, you know, it's not a lock.
Yeah, Mojo posted these for both of these contests. So yeah, we're sitting here in ninth place, the Lost Generation Opto 495.25. So we have two, three, four Mixons and one McPherson ahead of us. So we can get up to fourth.
Oh, up to fourth. Okay. I saw an extra chase as I was going through. All right, good.
Yeah. So, you know, depending on the extent of, obviously there's different gaps between each of these Mixons, but I believe Blair had done the math. And I think, getting up to this 504.65 would be about outscoring Mixon by about 10 points. If that were to happen and McPherson just chills out, we could finish as high as fourth, which is a pretty fun sweat.
Yeah, it is.
So that's that. We got, you know, some of our, these are our Leone teams down here, Leone SC 17. We do have a Mixon team here. So slightly hedged, but man,
56 is in 41st as well.
Okay. There you go.
Yeah.
We got our friend Chess Liam here. Chess Liam here, the man on the heater of a lifetime.
He was live to win it going into the conference championships, I think.
Yeah, Sam asking. I was wondering this too when I looked at it. I mean, you know, all Cooper Cup and then just a similar, you know, what, like 45 or even more, like 50% mix in, 49% chase, and then a
Evan. But the gap here, from the top to the bottom is only like 24 points. I think there's definitely Burrow teams that are live. I mean, because you get the 2x points. If he has a big game thrown to like Higgins and Boyd a little bit more, like he could definitely be, you know, he can shoot up really quick with the 2x points. Where
for sure.
I also wonder if there's any Higgins teams that are live with the 2x points. Like, we know Higgins has had a 40 point game. Like,
yeah,
he could blow up.
Looks like Willis was scrolling through there. Didn't see any Burrow teams in the top 300, which is pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, it makes sense that these guys have been able to separate. And I guess, I mean, what did Burrow's percentage end up being? How utilized was he?
It was only like 6% or something.
Yeah, that sounds right.
It was single digits.
Yeah, so just a pretty small sample there. What was our sweat last year? It was something with Mike Evans going.
Mike Evans, right? Needing to outscore
Brady, and he needed to outscore Brady by a lot.
Yeah, by a lot, yeah.
And Gronk is the one who ended up doing it. He had like the – we needed it to be very concentrated to Evans and end up being Gronk, who had the 2-touchdown game in the Super Bowl. But like if Evans would have had the 2-touchdown game where he like outscored Brady, I think he had outscored him. Maybe not by a lot, but it just felt like a lot because he was catching the passes from Brady. But it was maybe like 5 or 8 points or 9. I think it was like 8 or 9 maybe. And anyway, I think Gronk actually ended up basically doing what we needed Evans to do. We had Sean Corner, the odds maker, put odds on our on our sweat.
Yes.
We told him the parameters, and he said it was a 4% chance. So we felt like we had a 4% chance to win, and it didn't hit.
I feel much, much better about our chances of Jamar Chase outscoring, you know, Joe Mixon by 10 points. That actually feels well within the range of outcomes.
Yeah. That feels well within the range, yeah.
And are the Rams stronger against the run or the pass?
It's pretty neutral. They're not really a funnel. There's no real funnel. The only funnel left was actually, well, still the Bengals. The Bengals are a pass funnel.
Oh, so you're saying Cooper Kupp's a good play?
Cooper Kupp's a good play.
Well, everyone has him. So that is the one thing about this contest. It's where it's just like, there's just like zero sweats on the Rams side. Like it's just, it's all done.
It's just who do you have on the Cincinnati? You really can't catch anybody. Like, I guess maybe there's an Odell team lurking somewhere, but he was played so infrequently that I doubt it. The payout for fourth. This is a good question. I think it's 25K.
Let's see.
Yeah, it's 25K. I just looked.
25K split 5 ways.
5 ways.
Hassan said he's throwing a kegger at his house. We're all invited if we finish fourth, except no Australians.
No Australians are allowed.
I mean, it's like a real sweat because, like, if we finish 14th, the payout is 5K, which is we don't want that. We want the 5X return here.
It's a sweat. All right, guys. So the deal with this big board is it does include the rookies. I literally couldn't name a single rookie right now. Luckily, Pat has been in the lab. Gretch has been talking with Sean. So you guys are going to have to carry us here. But do you want to just fly by the seat of our pants and hop in one of these?
Yeah, let's do it. Do you want to do like a quick talk about the rookies, or you just want to go?
Yeah. Give us a quick one of like, you know, the who are the rookies that could potentially be, you know, top 10 round picks, basically.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's see. I'll start with the now my spreadsheets are slow. But Ben had it right that there's some real guys at the top. Treylon Burks, I think, jumps out as sort of the top guy to me from a fantasy perspective, although he won't be the first guy drafted. But the reason he jumps out is just total dominator in terms of market share. He's from Arkansas. He's not like a small school guy. He looks super athletic to me. I mean, obviously, we'll have to see how he tests, but He's a big wide receiver. I think he's like 6'2". He's like over 220. Kind of built like, you know, a number one wide receiver. He'll probably be a first round pick, maybe a second round pick, but he's not going to fall very far. He was awesome in yards per route run. Much better than his teammates. He has a 36% career market share of yards, which is fantastic. Sophomore breakout, true early declare. By the way, I would recommend Anthony Amico has put together a database that established a run that has all of the early declare status, how many years they spent, what high school class they were, their age, their date of birth. And I know he was like scouring like Instagrams and stuff to like get these date of births all together. So if you don't subscribe to them for some reason, you should and get that there. But yeah, so Burks jumps out. Drake London really jumps out as well. I think he'll probably get drafted first, a little bit less in yards per route run, but another really big wide receiver. He looks like Vincent Jackson or something. He's like 6'4". Like he's like really big, even bigger than Burks. So I think those two guys are the most interesting to me. Williams, obviously, with the injury. Otherwise, he'd be super interesting. And then you've got these two Ohio State guys, Garrett Wilson and Chris Olave, is it? They're both, like, I think kind of like late first round dynasty picks sort of grade is how I'm looking at them right now. I'm still very early in everything, but that's just like kind of my first pass. That's how they looked. But yeah, Olave's a senior, but Garrett Wilson, the other Ohio State guy, is an underclassman. And he's like sort of the 1 year wonder type dude. But both guys look pretty interesting. And I feel like we always miss on the Ohio State guys, but these guys actually like look pretty good in the numbers and they're both projected to be first round picks.
Eric asking about Isaiah Spiller. Is there a relation to CJ Spiller?
Spillers is a running back. Let me pull up my notes on the running backs. I actually have no idea if there's a relationship.
Spiller's not the most common last name in a running back. I'm like, it's got to be a chance.
It's funny. He does like, he looks like a little bit like CJ Spiller in his style, but he's like kind of, I was watching him. He's like kind of doing like a lot of moves and stuff. He looks kind of look like a little bit Matt Forte-ish to me. My worry actually is he's not all that fast as I was looking at him.
Tommy confirms not related. So there goes my dream.
Okay. The guy who jumps out to me as a running back is like probably the dude who for this we want to be interested in is Breece Hall. He's from Iowa State. He like just dominated elusive rating. He's not much of a pass catcher. Like he kind of reminds me of maybe like he's going to be like a Josh Jacobs or a Mark Ingram type. Like, I don't think he'll be a zero as a pass catcher, but he's not going to be awesome. But he just sort of profiles as the type of dude who gets drafted in the second round, is sort of slots in immediately to a starting role as the type of guy who we're going to end up drafting in like the third or fourth round.
3 year college career, has size, 23 TDs each of his last 2 years. Sean was talking about him too and was referencing how like he's basically David Montgomery 2.0. I mean, Montgomery. Yeah.
Yeah. I literally have a note. It says Mark Ingram / Josh Jacobs type question mark. Maybe David Montgomery question mark.
Right. They went to the same school. He's like the new version of him.
I love it. I said, you know, he's young. He is young. He profiles like a workhorse. I kind of feel like he's eventually going to be too expensive. He's probably too expensive at Dynasty. He's going to eventually be too expensive probably in redraft. But it's the type of guy where if you're getting him cheap now, I think it's a really good pick because the projected touches will be there probably.
All right. Let's let this rip. Well, we got to go out of our way to get one rookie at least, though, to feel a little bit alive.
Our first draft of the year last year was FFPC, but we had all those rookies that we loved all year. Pat got us on like Pitts in the 9th round and all this stuff.
And our first gauntlet draft we did back in December or whatever. That was the Chiefs, Mahomes and Cowboys draft that we crushed. Oh, that's right. So we run hot on these first drafts.
Yeah.
And we just got the influencer 101.
Beautiful.
I love it.
Now
are we all agreed? I think it's Taylor.
Yeah, especially in half. I mean, I'm going to make cases for McCaffrey at various points, but let's take Taylor.
What's the deal with McCaffrey right now? Is he projected to be full health?
He should be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He didn't have anything too serious, right?
No, yeah. I hadn't heard any updates on his stuff.
I think he's projected to play for fucking Matt Rhule and who's the new OC from the Giants?
Yeah. Bob McAdoo.
Oh, God.
McAdoo. Ben McAdoo, right?
Yeah.
Bob McAdoo. McAdoo. I didn't want to do what you just did. That's why I was stopping myself. I didn't want to say Bob McAdoo. The basketball player.
I'm trying to change his name from Ben to anything else. Literally anything else.
That's Ben has Omnifantasy brain.
Sorry, Willis, didn't get in. I know I pump faked people pulling up the draft screen earlier, but I will make a promise to you all. We are going to be doing lots of drafting on this show over the next few months. We're going to hop in some of the FFPC. They have their $125 early best ball contest. Underdog will keep pumping these out. So plenty of drafting coming. I trust you. Trust me, I should say. It is weird. I guess I'm curious where I know there's been
four. How does Henry go ahead of McCaffrey? I'm sorry.
That's literally what I was just going to say. I was confused. Yeah,
I'm not into that.
How that ADP is kind of settled there already.
I don't know why it makes me so angry, but it makes me angry. I mean, like McCaffrey is in PPR, but he's shown he's a 30 point per game guy.
Yeah.
Like even if he's not if everyone's afraid he's hurt and all this stuff, yada, yada, even if he's not 100% snap share guy anymore, 75% snap share, like he has a skill set that is going to be elite if healthy. And you can't bank on anything at running back other than ceiling. And he has that I want to fucking chase that. We're one of 12 to win a league anyway. I want to chase the fact that he can be a 30 point guy, you know? One per game guy. Yeah.
I agree with you. However, are you at all worried with McCaffrey that it could just be like the 2021 Giants, or it's just like one of these offenses? It's such a disaster. We don't believe in the coaches at all. The quarterback situation, who knows? It's probably going to be horrendous.
But then what is McCaffrey like, 20 points per game? I mean, is he like, he's like legit Henry's ceiling at that point? Maybe not in half.
Maybe, but I mean, we just saw with Barkley, like, then we start to, you know, if once things get bad enough, even McCaffrey's now, what, he's going to be in his fifth year or sixth year? I think fifth year. So he could be tailing off slightly in a way where we would probably never notice if he was in a good situation, but we might notice it like it might look very stark in a bad situation. I'm with you on the McCaffrey thing, but I just like,
yeah, that's fair.
That's the worry I have.
I have a tendency to blow through red flags. I mean, that's a good counterpoint, but I will say, I mean, I was looking at like Marshall Faulk the other day, and I literally think McCaffrey's in that realm as a player. And like, even like the Barkley thing, like Barkley doesn't run the routes that McCaffrey runs. He runs like that's slot true. Receiver routes at linebackers, yeah, and runs option routes. Does. And every coach has used him that way. I mean, it would be, I did this with Dave Johnson too. I thought they would keep using him out wide, but McCaffrey's skill set is just so clear. I just don't think, and Rhule's already used him that way. It's just, yeah, it's hard to imagine he wouldn't get the receptions at least.
Guys, did you miss being in a ship chasing draft when you go to look at the available players and all the wide receivers are gone?
Oh, hell yeah. Let's hit some.
Well, what wide receivers are here?
Yeah. We still have.
No, I mean, we still have some wide receivers that can play.
I mean, to me, I mean, DK Metcalf is a smash if he makes
all
it
these.
To us.
Yeah, I love DK Metcalf. Ridley, T. Higgins, I'd take.
Ridley's way down there. Like, that's just a discount.
Any relapse for us elite tight end bros here?
I mean, I would take
Andrews
Kittle.
Just goes. Yeah,
I would take Kittle. Yeah.
Do you want to go Kittle and Metcalf?
Yeah, I'm good with any of these top three
here. Yeah, Waddle's a stud too. I would take any of them as well.
Cam Akers goes. I'm just going to check here. So, yeah. I mean, none of these running backs are doing it for me.
No, right? I wouldn't take any of these guys. I might have been interested in Chubb if he'd made it.
Do you want both wide receivers?
Yeah, let's go both wide receivers. Let's skip Kittle.
Skip Kittle.
We can do different stuff at tight end, right? Is that cool with you, Pat?
I prefer Kittle and Metcalf, but I guess I'm open.
I'm good with that.
You guys prefer the
I'll do Metcalf here. I was gonna draft Metcalf over Waddle anyways, just I can't draft Waddle over Metcalf personally.
I feel like there's a nice price on Kittle and I like it in the elite tight end, and I hate having to chase the crap tight ends that we project to be good. Because if Pitts or Waller would come back, then I'd be cool with Waddle, but
no, getting the elite tight end makes sense.
All right, let's give it a shot. Who jumps out to you guys right now? I mean, Debo Samuel, now up in the, you know, the mid second, he's obviously a huge jump. Javonte Williams at the 1-2 turn, huge jump. Any other ADPs kind of jumping out to you as being interesting?
I was just thinking after we took Kittle right away that I think in August, Pitts will go ahead of him pretty easily. I think Pitts will go up around Kelsey in August. I mean, Andrews is going to be up there too, but I think Pitts is going to be in that top tier.
And deservedly so. I mean, I was like skeptical of Pitts in a, was a rational way where we excitedly drafted him in a number of leagues. I have him in Dynasty, but like there was just kind of this feeling that like he's a lock to be this new stud tight end in the league. And I'm like skeptical that we're that good at predicting tight ends, but everyone was right. He's awesome. Like he's awesome. And I feel like his rookie year was maybe more bullish than people are.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's more bullish than people are. They're going to come back around to it when people look at it.
Yeah.
The stat to know is he scored one touchdown. Like that's why he wasn't as good for fantasy as he actually was. He had a 1,000-yard season as a rookie 21-year-old tight end. It's fucking insane.
And it's kind of like the DK Metcalf year two bet where he's literally just a wide receiver. So you're just hoping that he takes a second-year leap as a wide receiver. He runs routes like a wide receiver. Yeah. He's a big-bodied wide receiver. He gets tight end eligibility, but, like, frankly, he really probably shouldn't. And so you're drafting him like he's just a big wide receiver who's about to take a second-year leap who was awesome as a rookie.
And that you get to draft at the worst position.
Yeah.
Importantly, a super young rookie, right? Turned 21 in October. He started the season at 20. Right. So like, this is a dude that's going to start next year, still at 21. Like he was really good last year. We didn't see as much maybe as everyone wanted to see. We didn't see the Jamar Chase level explosiveness right away, but like a 21-year-old does that and he's going to be good. It's just, there's just no question. And he'll score more TDs. He's going to have regression on one touchdown on over 100 targets. That's not going to stick. Right. Like with his athleticism, it's just not going to stick.
Yeah, I mean, he might be a better pick than Kittle. And I think probably once projections come into it, he'll probably start going ahead of Kittle. So that might just be one where
Kittle's so good.
Yeah, he's so good. It's like hard. But we know that's gonna be Lance now. Kittle's ADP will probably fall because once projections come in, it's gonna be really hard to project Kittle for much because you know the pie is gonna shrink in the projections.
We do have two pissing yellow starts here. Chase 9 goes Cup, CeeDee Lamb, Jalen Waddle. Express goes Hill, Diggs, Hopkins. Just reflexively, it's like I don't feel like touching Hopkins, but what's your take on him?
I agree. That's reflexively. I like the younger trio that Chase has over Express's trio. Because, I mean, even Diggs, you guys know how much I love Diggs, but didn't look great. You know, I don't know if you want to be getting guys that could be past their peak.
Yeah.
I think it's maybe like, it's one of those things where if you're getting Hopkins where he got Deontay Johnson, it's like, wow, that's a pretty nice price. But in the third, it's just a little less fun. Yeah. But I'm not sure like who is he supposed to take? I guess I probably have taken Waller and then you come get, who else are they going to build the offense around in Las Vegas? I think Waller going late third is, I pretty much want whoever, like I can tell you right now, like if all these tight ends are going to be going in the third round, these three, I'm just going to take whichever one falls. Like they're all great picks in the third round.
Yeah. Yeah. Eric talking about Mark Andrews ADP says people drafting him as if the Ravens D and Dobbins will still all be hurt next season. Do you guys, I mean, cause we've, we've all been in on Mark Andrews for a long time. And this is what we had been hoping for when we were drafting him in the second round. Do you think he can keep that up?
I think it's like, at this point, my view on it is that the top five tight ends are the top five tight ends in the league with like no one near them. And I wouldn't probably take Mark Andrews in the second if I know I can get Kyle Pitts or Darren Waller on the wrap. I just probably wouldn't do that. I mean, maybe I'll do it to try to mix up the exposures a bit, but I don't think he's worth that premium.
Yeah. All right. I mean, we definitely have some familiar friends and in faces here.
A lot of names to pick from there.
Michael Thomas. I mean,
let's be honest, we're taking DJ Moore, right?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
I mean, it's like the boogeyman. I didn't want to say his name quite yet, but that's all I'm going to say.
I can't. I literally can't fathom taking Leonard Fournette there without Brady. So we're all in on DJ Moore. Who's our other pick here?
I think I would take Godwin, but I know he's got the ACL. I mean, don't you think he'll be back by week one or no? I mean, Elijah Moore is the other one that sticks out to me.
It feels a little early for Godwin to me, just with the injury risk. What else is available in terms of running back? I know we're in the dead zone, but just
like ETN, Jacobs.
ETN's a good pick.
ETN's the fun pick. I mean, ETN's the guy who definitely jumps up into the like early third if things continue to be bullish with him, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because we got Robinson's
hurt. Robinson's not going to play. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's not going to have an offseason.
Should we have some fun with ETN?
Let's have some fun.
Yeah. He's a dude I want to get exposure to in the early offseason, for sure.
That's a third round pick.
Yeah. I mean, maybe even second, depending on how everything goes. I mean, I know that's really like that's projecting the Jacksonville offense to be better, but.
Well, that's to me the funnest kind of thought experiment with these early drafts is like who has the potential to really jump and who has the potential. Like the Leonard Fournette pick, it's like all I see is downside risk. I see nothing that happens between now and the start of training camp that propels him up a round or two. Mm-hmm. I just don't see it. Whereas with ETN, I see that with the McCaffrey stuff. Like I think McCaffrey's going to be a consensus top two pick for basically all of August. So, like, where are the discounts you can get now?
Yeah.
You know, one that's – well, I guess this is kind of a downside thing, but there is some upside baked in – or not baked in is Aaron Jones, where, like, if Rodgers returns, Aaron Jones is probably worth, what, the 202 or the 203 or something?
Which is where he was going last year mostly.
Yeah, but in this draft, he went in the 303.
Yeah.
So he's an interesting one. I mean, that's a true gamble because if it's the Jordan Love experience, you're not going to be happy. But there's at least upside with the gamble. Where Fournette, I don't know what's the upside. Like Brady retired, like he's not coming back. I mean, even if he were to come back, probably wouldn't be this year.
What do you? Because this was the other kind of veteran name here. Shift asking our thoughts on Mike Thomas.
No idea.
This seems okay in the fifth round. Where he went, but I don't know. I guess like his issue was with, it seems like his issue was with, I don't know, was it with Peyton? Definitely an issue with the Saints.
The off-field stuff is almost concerns me more than the injuries, right? Like what are we going to get? Exactly. Who's the quarterback going to be? What's the team going to look like? They're going to be bad. He has a target earning potential, but like, do we know if he wants to play football? Sort of like, I don't know. I think this is good value. Drico asks if ETN's 2020 Antonio Gibson. I was going to say sort of the 2022 DeAndre Swift, where people are saying bad team, discounting the fact that he catches passes and can still excel on a bad team. And, you know, Swift was going in like the fourth round all offseason. We're like, we don't really want to touch that because the Lions are going to be terrible. At the same time, like, I don't think we can really compare ETN to anyone because we didn't see him play at all, right? It's kind of tough.
Yeah. And I would argue that Antonio Gibson is the type of player that you want to make bets on because, like, he had a strong rookie year, athletic, has size, potential to be a workhorse. It didn't work. But, like, the key thing is to keep the price in check, which, like, I very much did not do. So that's like the error with Gibson is to, you know, also recognize where the downside is with him and then try to keep the price in check. And in that sense, you would say like Javonte Williams would be a better comparison because he's already up at the 201 here.
Yeah.
And I'm excited Gibson, about Javonte Williams, and I'm ready to ignore all the advice I just gave about keeping the price in check with him. But I think he would probably be the comp.
It's a perfect comp. And Gibson was the Miles Sanders from the year before. Same thing. Second year running back, one at the 1-2 turn. I always think of Gibson and Miles Sanders from 2020 as 2021 Gibson as very
and Josh Jacobs was in that range as well.
Yeah.
As a second year back. Yeah.
So we do have our first rookie off the board here, Breece Hall in the sixth round.
Ooh. All right.
That feels like a nice value on Breece Hall from what I get. Like, right, when we see these, once he goes in the second round or third round, he'll probably end up in the fifth round of these drafts. So it's not like a huge discount, but that's not bad.
Right.
There's someone who said that Nick said he'd rather have Hall than ETN. I probably agree. I don't know enough about Breece Hall. Pat, you said he looks really good. He's got the size. He's going to get the draft capital, right? I mean, I think you probably want him.
Yeah, ETN. I think he could be a third round pick. Like the David Montgomery type pick is really like truly what he could end up being. But I mean, ETN was a really good prospect before he hurt himself. And obviously the situation is a disaster, but yeah, I mean, I could see the argument.
Let's see here. Adam Thielen goes, I'll put everybody up on the board. I will say, I mean, if we're pushing our chips in on the Giants, I don't mind buying a little low on Brandon Ayuk here. If we want to set up a Trey Lance stack later, if you don't have to tempt me with a good time.
I'm down with that. Burks looks
good. Yeah, let's do that. Yeah, we could do Burks too.
Let's do Burks too.
Yeah, we said we had to get a rookie here. I'm trying to see, is there anyone else that
Burks is going to be the favorite? I mean, Sean told me he's his top receiver right now.
Burks is like Burks is going to be the big like RotoViz guy. Like we're all going to love Burks. I'm telling you, he looks awesome. The thing about Burks is that's fun is like I don't know. I've literally just started like my deep dive today with like the numbers and stuff. But so I don't really know what the film evaluation is on these guys yet, but I have to imagine having watched a little bit of Burks that like people like him. It's like one of these guys you're like, yeah, that guy's good. Like he's good at football. He kind of jumps off the tape.
In the seventh at this point in the offseason, I mean, there's like the only downside, like if could he fall to the third round? Because if he goes in the second with his profile in fantasy, he's going to be a fifth round pick. If he goes,
I don't think he falls to the third. I don't think so. Not what I was looking at kind of, you know, I think he's PFF has him as like a late first round. ESPN has him as a late first round type of guy. PFF has him as 28th. Overall in the class.
So we just got him in like Waddle range from last year, but Waddle's profile wasn't one that everyone loved necessarily. Burks is one that like everyone's going to love his profile, right? I mean, I think he winds up a fifth round redraft pick at least.
Especially because Chase just this combination of size 6'3", 225 pound and speed is unrivaled in the class. I mean, if he's got size and speed, his production is unreal. His production compared to his teammates is unreal. Racked up 1,100 yards and 11 scores this season. True junior. Yeah. Sign me up. Let's go.
Yeah.
Pete, let's demonetize this as soon as we're done this draft and watch him trail in Burks.
Well, unfortunately, in the StreamYard system, I only have JJ Taylor cut up.
So we can just watch JJ Taylor and say it's trail in Burks.
One thing I was noticing so far outside of this early Josh Allen picks, everyone else was prioritizing stacking with their early QB picks, Herbert to Keenan, Mahomes to Kelsey, Kyler to Hopkins. We have a Lamar and J.K. Dobbins and then backdoors Marquise Brown, Dak to Amari. This guy here took Shady took Joe Burrow unstacked. When do we start thinking about quarterback?
Good question.
Who's DJ Moore's quarterback going to be? I couldn't say it.
I mean, at Holy some point cow. We should take Trey Lance because, like, you know, he is going to be the starter now. I know we burned a lot of money on Trey Lance, but we got Kittle.
No, I mean, game for Trey Lance next
round.
Would you look
up the definition of the word martingale in the dictionary? There's a picture of Trey Lance. Trey Lance,
maybe. It is wild that they refused to play him in the playoffs and then immediately told Jimmy they were trading him. Like, what?
We could also take
that decision made.
Not immediately, but Russ is another option if we're taking Metcalf. I don't. What do you guys think? Do you think Russ gets? I don't think Russ gets traded.
I don't think he does either. I really would love to, but
he's been talked about all season. We've gotten every team that needs a quarterback. Some beat writer has written an article about what it would take to get Russ Wilson during the 2021 football season. But every time I saw that, I was like, I mean, come on, it's not going to happen, is it?
So, I mean, I don't think we necessarily have to do a quarterback at this 8-9 turn. I don't see any reason we need to. I mean, some interesting names here for sure.
I mean, I'd be into Lance here. I mean, that's like a real, there's real upside with him.
No, I mean,
how about you,
Ken
Kittle?
I'm with you. But wait, did Lance go?
Who would
have picked? I missed it. He went.
Who took an unstacked Lance?
Maybe as Debo.
No, Chris Donaldson. Yeah, completely unstacked. Just raw dogging it with Trey Lance.
All right.
Well, my take of saying that we could wait on Trey Lance not aging very
didn't
well.
Age well.
Didn't even get to us.
Well, let's get some more receivers. We're not like super deep at receiver.
So, Nick, if we want a galaxy brain here, Nick's saying good shot. Burks ends up in Philly. We also have Jalen Hurts on the board. Nick really giving us the hard sell on a potential Hurts to Burks stack.
I mean, they just took Rager and Devonta Smith in the last couple of years. Are they going to take another first round receiver? Maybe.
Rager doesn't seem long for the NFL from what
I've
seen.
Yeah, Rager's not a first round.
But I mean, it's a thing where like burned. The teams keep taking receivers in the first
round. I would.
You know, I probably would too. I like Bateman here.
I was going to say Bateman was – I can't believe
Gretch like
and I are pounding the table more than Pat for Bateman.
I love it.
What do you think about the Hurts stuff though? I mean, just in a vacuum, even without the potential Burks stack.
I'm okay with Hurts.
Yeah, I am too, but I also feel like we can wait on QB. I mean, I think I would go another receiver here. We only have five. And I
agree.
Isn't Olave pretty good too? Like, let's get another rookie.
Yeah, Olave is supposed to be pretty good. This is like maybe a little early for him because he's not an ideal prospect, but.
Okay. Let's take Hurts then.
We could take Gabe Davis.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty nice. I thought he was going to go way earlier than this.
I'm down.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised.
That seems like late, right?
Yeah, that's a dude that's not going to go later than this in August.
No, he's going to be a seventh round pick.
Yeah,
I think.
I don't think he's going to go in like. I mean, maybe he goes in like the 11th if like I don't know they add other receivers or something. But feels like he just blew up. A great example of what you were saying, Pete, where he can really only rise.
Yeah. Plus.
And Jefferson's right there. Yeah.
I think it's pretty. So they just brought in Joe Brady, which is pretty sweet.
I can't believe I'm going to fade Vic Jefferson in the ninth round this year. That's going to be so fun.
Are you guys excited about that?
Fading Vic Jefferson? Jefferson?
No, about the Bills adding Joe Brady.
Yeah, that looked great.
I think that's exciting. And then apparently Ken Dorsey is the new OC. Dayball was like trying to get, and Josh Allen had to campaign for them to keep him. So like any concerns about like, you know, offensive continuity and are they going to be as aggressive, which I like had, because Dayball I think has been really good for them. The fact that Josh Allen got his guys, the OC, and Joe Brady, who I think is sharp, is going to be there and was literally fired for running not enough. Sounds great. I think they're going to be pass heavy and smart.
Does sound fun. I mean, the Gabe Davis stuff, I mean, it checks every box, right? Like, I mean, I guess I'm kind of surprised he's not higher.
Easy like, pick.
If Gabe Davis went in the sixth round of this draft, I wouldn't have blinked an eye. I would have been like, holy cow, someone's taking Gabe Davis there.
Well, like Darnell Mooney went in the 703 range, and I think that's fine. But like,
yeah.
Would you rather have him or Gabe Davis?
Yeah. Yeah. I guess there is going to be a point where I could see Gabe even getting steamed up past where we're comfortable.
Yeah.
But now is not that time.
Willis says, I feel like we can wait on QB. Famous last words for 2022 underdog drafts. I'm not aware of this phenomenon. Are we going to hate ourselves? Because I did feel like we could wait on QB, but maybe we can't.
Why don't we take three?
Let's just take fucking three. I know you're never supposed to take three. Let's just do it.
We'll do it.
You guys hate it.
I'll fucking do it, man.
Don't test Pete. You'll fucking do it.
I mean, the second the show ends, I'll text Gretch and start bitching about take three. But I'll do it.
Let's take three guys who are going to have jobs and keep finding these values, man. Look at these values we found.
Yeah.
Who's going to have jobs, though? we might not know. Derek Carr season.
Derek Carr. Yep. That's one of the guys.
Wow. Yeah, maybe we should have taken a quarterback when Deshaun Watson's gone.
That's a guy who might not have a job, so that's not someone I would have suggested.
Yeah. I don't feel great about that pick.
At least the rookie QBs suck. I'm sure we'll find some rookies to fall in love with, to burn some 13th round picks on.
So what other rookies are off the board here?
What? GA's doing another one of these drafts at the same time, and he says one guy's taking four QBs already. What kind of person is chomping at the bit to do a best ball draft on February 2nd, but also taking four QBs? I would love to meet that individual.
Can you pull up the ADP?
Yeah.
That would too. It's crazy.
So I see at least about five that I feel good with.
What about the wide receivers?
I mean, you can get all the way down to like Matt Ryan. Like Matt Ryan might not be back with the Falcons, but Matt Ryan's going to play quarterback in the NFL in 2022. It's just like Stafford last year was going super late when he was still with the Lions. And people were like, well, what's going to happen? He got traded and he had a great year. I mean, he's a starting quarterback.
This is also a good point here. The 20 rounds definitely, I think, shift some stuff that's optimal. JW here says low-key think 3QB might be optimal in this format, especially with 20 rounds. I do want to say I recall even seeing stuff with the DraftKings 20 round drafts that the three quarterbacks were more optimal.
How long is this format contest run? What are we competing through against through?
I don't know if they have a close date on this one. It's pre-draft. It won't go
past like March or something.
The latest it would go would be the NFL draft.
Okay.
Would just be my guess, but I bet it fills. I could be wrong.
We'll see.
What about running back?
Running back, believe it or not, looks pretty gross.
Good thing you got Taylor and ETN.
So I'll tell you who's interesting.
Him.
Is at running back that this Kyren Williams guy,
yeah,
is on the list. I don't know what his ADP is.
Looks like it's down here a little bit.
Okay.
Sorry, we are on the clock here.
Kind of like QB, just to get some.
Okay.
Which QBs do you like, Gretch?
I mean, we have ETN. I was thinking Lawrence. I know it's like a little like really early for him, but the other rookies have already gone.
I think we can throw out ADP on QBs now.
Yeah, Urban's not there. You can make yourself a case. And then the other one I was looking at was Carr. I don't know about Tannehill. I mean, Tannehill maybe. There's like talk that Rodgers could end up in Tennessee.
I saw that.
It's like, what?
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, we don't have a ton of other stack options that unless I'm missing something. Yeah.
We could also Cousins. Backdoor
Lawrence, they're about to get the Rams OC.
Okay.
Are they definitely going to have Cousins next year? They are, right? He's like locked in.
He's under contract. I mean, they could trade him, but they got to.
Yeah, $45 million in dead money if he's cut. So,
yeah.
He's going to be a starter somewhere. $10 million if they can trade him. Yeah.
I just I just want to savor this moment where right now in the 11th round, I look at all these running backs and I'm like, yeah, it's pretty gross. Come August, I'm going to think that every one of these running backs from the 10th round on just look incredible. Like, I'm just going to fall in love with so many late round running backs. So I'm going to savor this moment right now.
I'm about to tuck into two of them right now.
Oh boy, here we go. I was about to float a Mac Jones, Jacoby Myers stack. So, I mean, I saved you guys from that.
I would have been into it.
I would have played that too. Oh,
yeah, it would have been the easiest sell of your life.
Why not?
I think Mac Jones is good.
Lawrence, yeah. Cousins, I mean, probably too early at 10, 11 turn. We're going to look back on that and be like, oh, we didn't have to take him that early. But I think it's fine.
I don't think so. The way QBs were starting to fly off the board here, I do think QB ADP will get pushed down from this as the summer progresses a bit.
I kind of wish we pushed it and just like, because are we taking three or are we just taking two now?
I think this can still definitely be a three QB build. So our team so far, if you guys are listening to the audio version, quarterback Trevor Lawrence, Kirk Cousins, running backs Jonathan Taylor, Travis Etienne, and our wide receivers DK Metcalf, DJ Moore, Brandon Ayuk, Treylon Burks, Rashad Bateman, Gabriel Davis, and tight end George Kittle.
It's a good team.
Yeah.
Wish we would have gotten Lance.
Who?
Yeah. Lance? The unstacked Lance pick is definitely sticking in my craw a little bit here.
I'm just thankful that Lance didn't make it to us, and then I told us to wait. Like, I was just absolved of what would have been even more embarrassing.
Did Garrett Gilbert go?
Wait, that's a quarterback. That's not a quarterback that you want to draft.
Garrett Wilson. Like, still learning these guys. Garrett Wilson, the Ohio State guy.
Yeah, he went.
Okay.
Chris, he snakes us on everything. Trey Lance, Garrett Wilson.
Nice pick, Chris. Nice pick. Gotta get Garrett Gilbert. Double up the Garretts.
He's looking like he might be like a top 10 pick, Garrett Wilson.
Yeah.
I saw in some spots. He's a good pick. He could be the rookie to be on as well. He's the other Ohio State guy, him and Olave.
Yeah. Both of them look like pretty good pick. Like, I'm excited to kind of be on the Ohio State guys for once.
I guess I haven't read anything about DJ Chark's rehab, but that would have been a fun pick with Trevor if we were making a bet and getting a pretty nice.
But you know
who
we're going to take instead in the 15th round.
Yeah, you know what we're doing.
Shift knows what we're doing too. The Lawrence pick
everyone knows what we're doing.
Roll the clip.
And no one's going to snipe us on it because no one wants to take
it.
Someone please.
No, Pete, how dare you?
I'm not in the mood to play that clip right now.
How dare you, Pete?
The wounds are still fresh.
We just took Trimmer and Lawrence. Terrible.
I'd rather draft JJ Taylor and play that clip.
Oh, no.
Lawrence is going to throw at least like 5-6 touchdowns to ETN this year. That's going to be money.
Will Fuller, and by the way, Underdog, William Fuller. That almost seems like a dig just to call him William Fuller. But he'll be playing somewhere. That seems like a nice value there.
Yeah.
That is a name change on the Underdog system. It definitely didn't say William Fuller last offseason.
It definitely didn't, and it does feel like a dig.
William Fuller.
No one calls him William Fuller.
Who are we stacking Cousins with? Like KJ Osborne.
KJ Osborne just went.
Like Irv Smith is our other tight end, maybe.
I'm into that.
Yeah, that makes sense. Let's see what the tight end ADP is looking like. I think Irv makes sense.
Yeah.
Cole Kmet seems like a decent value here in the third.
Oh, yeah. He's actually up there. I thought Irv would be completely forgotten about. He's like on the list. I didn't want to take him soon.
Yeah. Wide receivers. Oh, look at this dusty vet string.
This is the fifth highest receiver.
Oh, there you go. Thank you, Shady.
Oh, come on, man.
I wish you were doing a stream so I could give you a super chat for that.
At this point, like, just, you know, to watch us have to roll the clip at this point. Like, why would you snipe that from yourself?
Although it was funny that we were on his name and talking about him and he disappeared. I mean, that was
yeah. Well, it's happened before.
I don't like these running back here.
Yeah, go to running back.
Who are you going to talk us into that you were teasing earlier?
Did he go? Oh, damn it. Did he go? Kyren Williams.
Yeah, he went.
He went.
Ah, what a bummer.
You thought you had uncovered a gem.
All right, we're on the clock.
I think Ronald Jones.
Ronald Jones is a free agent.
Ronald Jones is actually a pretty good pick here.
Let's do it. Roll the clip.
What tight end do we want? Kmet or
I like Kmet for sure, but I would take her.
I like that. I like her for the stack, but I wouldn't fight Kmet.
Let's do it.
Which I'm gonna take Rojo. Which one, Irv or Kmet?
If you guys like Irv for the stack,
break the tie.
Yeah.
Let's get the stack. We're not gonna have anyone else to stack Kirk up with.
Okay.
All right, guys. Congratulations. We just drafted Ronald Jones. Ronald Jones will get the call.
All yeah, right.
We're back. The brand is intact. You can take away our Visca, but Ronald Jones's ADP is too low to take him.
He's always in the 12th round. Literally every draft we do, it's like, well, at this point, he's kind of a good pick.
Free agent. He's not going to land as a starter somewhere, but like.
No. But, you know, at this point, we're taking, like, Alexander Mattison went, I assume, right?
We've said this a million times, but this dude is actually a good runner. Like, you know, a team like the Ravens or somebody, if he could ever land in a situation like that, that's like good for a runner, he could have 1,000-yard season.
Good for a runner and then like a laid back coach, doesn't mind like you know mental errors and just sort of general screw ups and outlandish behavior, whatever it is.
He can be the AJ Dillon to somebody, you know, who's just sort of like the secondary back, but actually doing consistent work. Like he can. It's Arians that is, you know, jerked around sort of his usage.
What's the dream landing spot right now for Rojo?
I said Ravens because that's who I wanted in season trade, but they obviously have both Dobbins and Edwards coming back. I don't know. Bills?
Say Bills? No, I don't think Bills.
Go along with Singletary? Yeah, I mean, they're not going to run enough, but I think Moss is kind of .
There you go. Our San Fran stack, our naked San Fran stack hits.
If Foreman wasn't back, which why wouldn't they bring Foreman back? But if he was behind Derrick Henry,
that's a good compliment,
right? That'd be nice.
He's but like a better version. Yeah. Back. Yeah.
Were you gonna say it's a better version of Derrick Henry?
I was gonna say better version of Dante Foreman, but then Pat made it sound like maybe he's not.
I think he is, but it just like for the money, right? You're not gonna have to pay Foreman anything.
So
look at, like,
we came to the conclusion that we can't come up with an ideal landing spot for.
Right. I want to look at all the teams and try to figure this out.
That's not bad.
You know, one actually.
Oh, Saints. Saints would be a good one.
Saints would be really good.
That's actually a great fit.
A new quarterback and regime, but a good offensive line.
Falcons.
Still.
Falcons would be good.
Yep.
Falcons would be great.
Falcons would be really good. And Saints. I like those.
Those are the spots. Yeah. Falcons, you could see as well, you know, because he's not going to be like super expensive.
Daniel Jones, 14th round pick. Don't hate it.
He'll have a job.
He could land somewhere like New England, and that would be kind of fun.
Jones. Wow.
Rojo?
I mean, I know they would hate him, but
Rojo would get buried on the bench in like training camp.
Yeah.
Where did you say?
New England.
Belichick would be a disaster.
Belichick would cut him, and somehow like no one would pick him up. Like he would cut him so hard that he would be out of the league. You better stay away from New England, Rojo.
Go to Atlanta, please. That Ronald Jones and Bill Belichick.
It's the right running system, but this is a good point.
I just, it almost feels like if I told you that Tom Brady like texted Bill Belichick frequently about how much he hates Ronald Jones? Would that surprise you?
No, it honestly wouldn't. Like, no. Don't do it. I mean, it would be crazy to me if they even offered him something.
Yeah, that's fair.
So positionally, we're pretty well spread. No glaring positional needs.
So the other guy that I think is fun is right up here in the running back list.
I like that. Sorry, what?
Well, let me just see.
Rashad?
This guy have 8 running backs?
Yes. This is
what's going on, Sam. Your tweet changed ADP. Your tweet was like the equivalent of the episode we did.
I think some of these guys are drafting these autopilot, and I don't know. All right, we have 15 seconds.
Let's do Rashad White. He's the other guy I wanted to talk you guys into.
Yeah, nice. This is the repeat of our first draft last year, where Pete and I can look up who he is after the draft.
Yeah. Well, I called him Rashad White at first. So that's
I'm guessing as well. I actually don't know his name.
That's exactly the same as Terrence Marshall last year that we watched Terrace House. I'll just go. So we figured out it's Terrace.
We have to figure out our other pick, though, because I don't have another rookie for us.
How about Nico Collins, second year breakout?
Yeah, it works for me.
He flashed enough, right? There's some legs there.
Yeah, a little bit. I felt like he didn't. I mean, it was a bad situation. He got a lot of routes, and he just didn't do a whole lot.
Yeah.
31 yards per game. That's not really what you want to see, but 15th round.
He came up a little bit at the end, but it wasn't an ideal showing.
What was his yards per route run? Do you have that? I don't think it was great. It couldn't have been.
It wasn't great. I don't know off the top of my head. It's probably like 1.35 or something.
He's the kind of guy that by August we might tell ourselves is just bad. But it is the 15th.
I think it's too early to say that.
Okay.
You know. Because he wasn't like JJ or Thega Whiteside, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And it was a bad team.
Yeah.
Although Brandon Cooks was good. I mean, Davis Mills was good down the stretch.
Man, 20 round drafts. I feel those 2 rounds. I'll be curious to.
I know. I'm like trying to find some more rookies for us.
What do we have? 2 tight ends, 2 QBs, 7 receivers right now, 3 running backs. Ooh, we
got
to take some.
No, we got 4 because we just added Rashad.
Okay.
We should probably take 1 more, right?
2, 4, 7, 2. Yeah. I think we still have kind of full positional.
Will you click on the running backs and just kind of scroll down? I just want to have a little.
It is, as Nick points out, it is probably just smashing rookies time.
Yeah. But I mean, like, okay. Jeff Wilson.
I'm just going to start reading rookies that look kind of interesting. And let me know if they're available, and then you can star them.
Okay.
So, did JD McKissick go?
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one. Mm. All right. Is Sky Moore too wise? Yep.
In the queue, no he's ADP.
He's a Western Michigan guy, underclassman. Probably going to be like a 3rd round pick, kind of like a good like last round pick. Or
can
like
I just say, that's the fucking sickest name I've ever seen for a wide receiver in my goddamn life. Sky with 2 Y's more.
That's what I call DJ Moore in my spare time, but I didn't know there was a real guy named this.
Sky Moore. I mean, that's like Chris Moneymaker. It's like a self fulfilling prophecy. God.
I love this so much. I literally feel like life returning to me for these fantasy drafts.
I mean, is that not the fact that it has 2 Y's? I mean, it's just like his hang time. He's up there for so long. They had to add an extra Y. I love it.
Yeah, man. Oh, it's a great name.
Thank you. Now, I swear to God, if someone takes Sky Moore from me right when I fell in love.
All right. Let's see. Who else we got? Is David Bell available?
No, gone.
Is Jahan, J-A-H-A-N, Dotson available?
Gone.
Is Jalen
getting running backs in there?
Jalen.
Pat has never drafted a running back.
I've never drafted a running back. Jalen Tolbert. Is he not in the player pool?
Oh, there. Oh, it's there with it. With no Y. Okay. No ADPs on either of these guys.
Okay. I'll switch over to running backs since we're coming up here.
This is how you draft for February.
Kenneth
2nd.
Walker available.
He's gone. Why does Kenneth Walker have an experience bad next to his name?
Honestly, that's kind of it. Like, I think the running backs, there's a couple like small school guys that are kind of interesting.
Hang on.
But I think
Eric
that's
hit
it.
Me with a Damian Pierce sleeper. Can I look for him?
Yeah, he's interesting. I think PFF's pretty high on him. But he didn't jump out to me in the first round, but he was like someone I flagged to look into further.
From Florida. He doesn't actually have very good numbers at all. Career high of 790 yards. I kind of like the guys that are actually productive. 4-year dude that wasn't very productive.
Yeah, when I say he didn't jump out to me because it wasn't, his numbers didn't really pop.
Yeah. But, I mean, if scouts love him, who knows? Oh, who are we gonna take? We're on the clock. Sony Michel.
I'm out of takes. I have zero takes other than wanting Sky Moore at some point.
I mean, we could just take Sky Moore.
I mean, we're gonna take Sky Moore. sometimes you just gotta get your guy. You gotta soar up there ahead of the ADP and grab him.
What about Justin Jackson? I mean, he was pretty monstrous at some points.
Yeah, there's also the Jeff Wilson, Trey Sermon.
Yeah.
I think Sony Michel would be a good pick as well.
You want to do Sony?
I'd go to Justin Jackson too.
Okay. Who do you want? Sony or Justin Jackson?
Let's do Jackson.
Ben's sleepy.
They might add another running back. Yeah, dude, my youngest came in my freaking room at 4 a.m. So my oldest came in and woke up my wife and made her go and lay in their room. And then the youngest left their room and came and woke me up and laid in bed with me for like a half an hour last night. It's hitting me right now. It was a fun night last night. Mm. Both kids decided to wake us up.
Don't love that. All right. Did Williams go? Who tore his ACL? He's a pretty good prospect. Maybe Jameson Williams.
Yeah, he's gone.
He went. Okay. What about?
I mean, I think the theme here is just like anyone doing these drafts is pretty excited about drafting these rookies.
Throw Matt Ryan in our queue for our third quarterback if you ever want to take a third quarterback.
Sure. Who the fuck is Kenny Pickett?
What about John Mechie?
Kenny Pickett's the new Mitch Trubisky, Joe Burrow mold. He had no production until his redshirt senior year. And then
Chris Donaldson, basically everyone we love in life, Chris Donaldson is drafted.
What about George Pickens?
Pickett or Pickens? Oh, Pickens.
He went.
He's gone.
Justin Ross with a Y.
George should partner with Underdog for George Pickens.
Oh, is Justin Ross in this class finally? I remember when he was a freshman.
He's not that good of a prospect. He's like fine. I remember being excited for him to be in this class for like 2 years, and now he finally is, and he's kind of like okay.
Because he then the lit last up guy, the national championship as a true freshman.
Star him, Pete Justin.
Justin Rose Ross.
Right, yeah, and then the last guy would be S H A K I R.
Khalil Shakur?
Yeah.
Tupac?
I think that's pretty much it for the guys who kind of looked like they might get drafted high and had interesting stuff going on.
Guys, are you ready to get demonetized? Because it's been alerted to my attention. Sky Moore pops off with 4 TDs. All TDs. Down there.
LB keeps. It's the slant again. It's Moore again.
Let's go.
touchdown, Western Michigan.
Too easy.
Where safety came from, Ellaby identified it. They go right
to the got to bring the safety over the top on Sky Moore.
And then throw it right in that
spot. I need to see his vertical leap here. Space and it allows you to block. Throwing fades to him. Sky's up.
Oh, let's go.
Just had a touchdown to Moore. Is it another one? Didn't
sky at all.
Yes, sir.
Going to call him ground boy.
I'm
going to
keep trying. I'm going to keep trying.
Sky one.
Sky Moore goes up for the ball.
Wants it all. Oh. Sky Moore is there, and he holds
Sky
it.
Doesn't leave the ground. That was actually pretty sweet.
On the snow cone catch.
True. I didn't think he had any chance of catching that when the ball was in the air.
God, this 4TD is going to be sick. I can feel it.
Another level of speed.
Are we on the clock?
Caught up to it.
No, there was 14 picks. We're 10 picks away. Everyone's watching this.
This is a throw that's up there high. And
they're like, man, why didn't I take this guy more than 12?
You guys got over the 13. Almost. Oh, and the way he sets that up, that's the other thing.
Nick's a 5'10 slot receiver. I thought he was fucking Megatron.
Pete fell in love with him for his name. That's a nice catch, though.
Oh, my God.
I'm going to be honest. That was not worth getting demonetized.
We should rugged again. I got rugged by Sky Moore. I read the roadmap. I thought it looked really promising, and then the devs took all my money.
Amazing. All right, let me tell you about these guys. Because are we taking some of these rookies, or what are we doing?
Sure.
All right.
I want to take Justin Ross just because I remember something from 4 years ago, but we don't have to. So
we
because
could.
It's the only one I've heard of. That's why. I haven't heard of any of the other ones.
look at our queue. It's random player rookies that Pat looked up, and then Ben's saying, toss Matt Ryan.
Toss Matt Ryan.
Dude, Ross is good. 26% dominator rating as a true freshman, and then even 28 last year. He never broke out, but like.
He never broke out. I mean, that's something we normally like.
Yeah,
he's not bad, but he's like supposed to be like a third round pick. Like he's not like the, I don't think the scouts are huge fans, and then his numbers aren't great. So you're, he's kind of like a second round dynasty pick type dude. These guys all are though. To be clear, we're past anyone you consider in the first round. Jalen Tolbert's interesting. He had a 36% career market share of yards. Went to South Alabama.
South Alabama and Clemson.
Yeah. 5-year player for Tolbert. So he might be like Tylan Wallace. Justin Ross is maybe, I don't know.
Ross missed all 2020. Did he just sit out because of COVID probably?
Probably. We can go Ross. Let's go Ross.
Justin Ross. And do we want to grab Matty Ryan as our third QB? Get three statues?
Yeah, let's get three statues.
All right, let's do it.
I've never felt more alive than I do with Trevor Lawrence, Kirk Cousins, and Matt Ryan as my quarterback. These are the teams you advance to the Best Ball Mania playoffs and then don't get out of the first round.
Nick's got kind of what I'm thinking. He said we've at least seen a huge ceiling from Ross. And to be clear, it was only like a 26% dominator rating as a rookie, but it was 1,000 yards – or as a freshman, it was 1,000-yard season on a national championship winning team. Like,
yeah,
in his true freshman year. Like, if he can get back to that – I mean, that's a great point.
He's also like, at that age, been really, really, really strong in yards per route run. He has a 3.41 career yards per route run, and he's an underclassman. He's not an underclassman, is he? So the 3.41 is from his first 3 years, so it doesn't include his senior year.
Okay.
I guess really the first 2 years since he sat out. So that's awesome. Like, to be able to do that is a – like. You know, your first couple of years in college, have 3.41. It's kind of like T. Higgins-esque.
So, speaking of T. Higgins, I just looked up Clemson. He had the 1,000-yard season. T. Higgins had 936 that year. Higgins had more touchdowns. And then Amari Rodgers and Hunter Renfrow were both on this team. They were both in the 500s. Ross had 1,000 yards as a true freshman on a team that had those three future NFL players.
That's pretty wild.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, he's shown that ceiling.
I'm definitely – he's starting – again, I'm still pretty early on in this, but the first look at him is like, yeah, he like really profiles as a boom bust type guy, which is exactly what you want here.
Right.
Ooh, Diami Brown this late seems fun.
I'm into that.
Yeah.
It's probably like a better version of the Nico pick, right?
Yeah. Because you might get a quarterback upgrade there.
Right.
I mean, you almost have to.
Well, I guess this is why we're learning on our feet.
Look, we got Sky Moore. We don't have to worry about the Nico pick.
I thought I drafted this 6'7", 230-pound behemoth who runs a 440.
Just look up Treylon Burks, man.
Jump out of the gym.
Pull up Treylon Burks. Cheer yourself up.
Yeah. Okay. We've already done highlights. You got to bring up Treylon Burks.
I'll do it.
Get the, I think it's the Sick Edits one is the name of the YouTube one.
Seriously?
Yeah. Sick Edits HD.
Who are these guys that fucking name these?
I don't know.
I can't even find Sick Edits.
Just type in Treylon Burks highlights on YouTube and then it'll be like the second one.
Well, I typed in Treylon Burks Sick Edit.
There you go.
Nothing.
Top one. The top
this?
One. Yeah, it's
by Sick Edit. Oh, sorry. I thought that was the name of the video, not the uploader with Sick Edits. Okay.
He's essentially a running back when he
I like a little cinematography with my highlight videos.
And it's just in the beginning, and then they get to pure highlights. It's nice.
Spectacular throw and catch. Hoping it's a dream, but it's facts.
He ain't Ricky, so no to his back. He's a big boy who can shoot.
Wow, I know. I expect those kind of moves from Sky Moore, but
yeah. Didn't see it coming. I made this before the Grammys. If I win the
Grammy, I'm going to take it to the trenches to the family. My sister lean out of being fans. Yeah, this is a thick boy.
Do you guys see like a little Julio here? He's a little Julio-esque. I mean, obviously we need the athleticism.
We just did the Julio racing story to, or whatever. All
right, I'm gonna go. I watched the tape. I've been so damaged through the years. With this between them, it made me close to my kids. What is he? Is he 6'3", 6'4"?
He's like 6'2", and a half, something like that. Okay. Yeah.
I mean, there's definitely bigger. Some Mike Williams in some of these contested catches, too.
For sure, yeah. And he still got it to
run. Oh, he caught his footing. Oh, he's doing it. He got his family time, and it's over.
This is an NFL wide receiver, right?
Yeah. There's the you guys are talking about AJP. I mean, have a little respect for this guy.
There's a slant right to him. Mississippi State.
It's a grown ass man. I'm calling it right now.
Oh, dude, he is. He was falling down. The guy still couldn't tackle.
1 minute 50 into Sick Edits, and I'm calling him. And Treylon Burks beats
him cleanly. You know, that's like, it kind of makes me think of a bigger OBJ a little bit too.
No. Okay. This guy.
We got this dude in the seventh round.
Yeah, dude.
This guy should be going at the 1-2 turn with
That's what I'm saying. Like, I don't. I mean, obviously, I need to read up a bunch, but it would shock me if, like, the film consensus on him wasn't strong.
I mean, if the film bros don't like this guy, burn down the film industry.
What are we doing if they don't like this guy?
I'm a little concerned with his ability to get off of press coverage.
I mean, there's obvious AJ Brown and Julio vibes here, right?
For sure, right?
I mean, it's just grown-ass man. I'm smitten. I like my thick boys.
All right,
we're on the clock.
All right, let's get back to it. And then I have two more fairly thick prospects to show you guys.
Just take Pat's next two thick prospects, whoever they are.
They're both taken.
All right, here we go. Mr. Irrelevant. Which one of these rookies? Jalen Brewer.
I would
we're
say
at 3.592.
Tolbert, productive upperclassman over. Or we could go Pierce if you guys want the running back.
I mean, I feel comfortable with our running backs.
All right, let's go Tolbert then.
Yeah.
Tolbert it is. There it is. The first draft of the year. Well, let me let's get these laid. This is my resolution for 2022 drafts. I name every draft right after.
Oh, that's smart, man.
I'll forget like 3 weeks in, but it seems like a good resolution right now. There we go. We did it.
I love it. All right. You want to pull up Drake London.
Mm-hmm.
He's like the bigger Treylon Burks. He honestly looks like Vincent Jackson. Like he's huge.
Okay. Oh, I'm going to sick edits again, dude. This is my dude now for.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of Just Bomb Productions, but sick edits, new to these streets, pretty good.
But if I call you my brother, that means you my brother.
You're right about the cinematography. It gets you in the mood.
It does. It's nice. And then it's like not overdone throughout.
What was your comp, Vincent Jackson?
Yeah.
Definitely saw like a little Mike Evans with that catch.
Yeah,
too.
Mike Evans. Yeah.
We don't have too many of those like 6'4", 6'5", receivers that are still pretty athletic.
This does look
I know. We could use
that. That was a good vert.
I'm just realizing how hilarious it is that Pat led with Skyboard. I only show these guys.
I didn't lead with Skyboard. We took Treylon Burks.
Yeah. I just want Skyboard to be so much more than what he is.
Skyboard is a flyer at the end.
Yeah,
this guy's gonna be a first round pick. That's what it looks like right now, anyway.
All right, you got another guy?
Yeah, I think people think who might be the first wide receiver taken. So the other guy. Was the running back I was hoping to. Oh, actually, we should do two running backs. But the first running back is Kyren Williams, who I was trying to get us to drop, but then he got sniped.
Let's see here. Wow, does sick edits only do wide receivers? It's my kind of guy. Now, grinding running back tape, this might be a bridge too far.
Yeah, I don't think I can watch running backs, what I'm looking at here.
Yeah, I mean, congrats. He caught a pass in the flat. I mean,
he's got some pretty nice highlights, although I don't know that this highlight video is going to be the one we want.
All right.
That looked like a really well-blocked play.
No, he's explosive.
I mean, if I wanted to watch this, I'd just queue up 8 hours of Sky Moore highlights, you know? Who is the last great Notre Dame running back to come into the league?
I mean, Ryan Grant was at a Notre Dame, right?
Was he?
Yeah, he wasn't
the
great.
Packers
but,
guy?
Yeah, the Packers
definitely been
guy.
A few. Back in like the 90s, so I can't think of any Notre Dame backs, though. There's definitely been some.
Man, but it's way more boring to watch these running backs. All right, let's do Rashad White, who we did take, I believe.
Luckily,
he's
I know
just
how to
like,
spell his name.
He's like a pure kind of pass-catching bet. He's like a bigger Kenneth Gainwell.
Senior, though. You hate to see it. Too old, you know? Probably has about 1.5 good years in him.
All I can think about is Eno Benjamin while I'm watching these highlights.
We just watched two wide receivers and declared them Mike Evans and Julio Jones. And now we watch some running backs and talk about how short their careers are going to be.
Hey, look, we're nothing if not on brand.
We're nothing about that is on the brand.
Most on brand thing we've ever done.
Oh, no. What is this guy, 23? Fire next year, probably.
I would draft this guy with your team.
Willis has had enough.
People hate watching it.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a pass-catching running back, too.
I'll get demonetized for Sky Moore. I ain't getting demonetized for this shit.
Well, anyway, we got some good wide receivers in this class. That's nice.
We do.
Julius Jones was a Notre Dame back.
Okay. Oh, that's right.
Josh Adams.
Kind of like busted and then unbusted, right?
Yeah, exactly.
He had like a very weird career.
Yeah, he wasn't very good early, but he ended up being pretty damn good with the Cowboys later. And I think he played for the Seahawks late in his career and was pretty good.
Well, I think we need to remember, in August, I think right before the season starts, someone remind us to go back and look at this draft. I bet it'll be absolutely hilarious.
It'll be hilarious.
How
also because we didn't really stack very well. Like it's not very good. We didn't execute it very well.
Well, here's the thing. I've always said about February drafts is you just draft the best players. And, everything else will work itself out.
Yeah, we've always said that.
This is a fun show. Gretch, where can when did you say the official Omni launch is going to be?
It's already. I haven't tweeted about it or anything, but you can start leagues. Omnifantasy.com. It redirects you, but Omnifantasy.com. It's good to go. I'm probably not going to do like a huge advertising blitz this year or anything, but it's fun. Fun little thing. If you get a group of friends together and do it.
Still free, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Can't beat it. Get a group of buddies together. We will get some ship chasing leagues going as well. We will be back as usual next Wednesday. Pat, anything else coming out for you here before the you doing Pro Bowl content, Pro Bowl walkthrough?
Yeah, Pro Bowl walkthrough. No, thank God I'm not doing that. No, I'll have a Super Bowl walkthrough out next week because that's when that content should be. And I'm going to be doing so in the off season. I should mention. I'm going to be doing a dynasty themed podcast on Thursdays at NBC Sports Edge. I believe that'll be at 4 o'clock Eastern in the afternoon on Thursdays. So check that out. Be kind of,
will you book me to come talk about Sky Moore?
Yeah. You're booked specifically for Sky Moore. It's going to be,
that's all. I want an hour deep dive on Sky Moore. Yeah,
it's going to be a tough hour.
It'll fly by, buddy. I'll tell you that.
Well, you know what, Pete? I mean, as people may or may not know, we did produce Fantasyland, and so we could do an hour-long background deep dive into Sky Moore and his life and journey into the NFL.
Yeah, you know what? Actually, what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to become like the Robert Caro of Sky Moore and basically just spend my entire life writing a biography about Sky Moore. I think is what I'm going to do.
I love it.
Gretch, any other final words here?
Nope. I'm excited to learn more about these rookies, man. That was fun.
Yeah. We will start to slide down the rabbit hole as the offseason progresses. Hope you guys enjoy your Pro Bowl weekend. We will be back next week, right before the Super Bowl. That will be very fun. Hope you guys all have a great weekend. We'll see you then.